Joining me today is Paris Dennard. He is the RNC Senior Communication Advisor for Black Media Affairs. Thank you for joining us today.
Thanks for having me.
So I just want to get your reaction. Yesterday was the vice presidential debate. What was your impression of that debate, and who do you think emerged the winner?
Hands down, Vice President Mike Pence won the debate. He had a command of the facts. He had a command of the record of not only President Trump and the administration which he's a part of, but he also had a command of the record of Kamala Harris, not just as a United States Senator, which is deplorable, especially as it relates to the Black community, but her record as a DA and as the Attorney General in California. It was important for the American people to finally have an examination of her record and to finally be able to hold her accountable for just some of the things that she should be held accountable on, especially on the record of criminal justice reform. Vice President Pence made it very clear that she has been MIA on it when it comes to criminal justice reform in the United States Senate, and she was MIA on the issue of criminal justice reform when she was in California in leadership at the local level.
Yes, Mike Pence did call her out yesterday. Let's check it out.
In San Francisco, when you left office, African Americans were 19 times more likely to be prosecuted for minor drug offenses than whites and Hispanics. When you were Attorney General of California,
you
increased the disproportionate incarceration of blacks in California. You did nothing on criminal justice reform in California. You didn't lift a finger to pass the First Step Act on Capitol Hill.
You know, prior to running for the presidential campaign, Kamala would usually refer to herself as a top cop. I want to read a quote from her 2009 book, Smart on Crime, where she said, quote, "If we take a show of hands of those who would like to see more police officers on the street, mine will shoot up." She also added that, quote, "Virtually all law-abiding citizens will feel safer when they see officers walking a beat." But earlier this year, after the death of George Floyd, she stepped back of that comment where she told the New York Times, quote, "It is status quo thinking to believe that putting more police on the street costs more safety. That's wrong. It's just wrong." What do you think changed? Why do you think, you know, the 2009 Kamala Harris is different from the 2020 Kamala Harris?
Kamala Harris is flip-flopping on her stance on criminal justice issues because she's a hypocrite and she's an opportunist. There's no better answer than that. That is the fact. When you look at a woman who stood before the American people and said that she believed the accusers of Joe Biden, like Tara Reid, she called him the things that he said in terms of working with segregationists and how she was hurt by his comments and his work in terms of busing and how it led to him saying that he did not want to have integrated schools because it would lead to a racial jungle. This is the same woman who now stands proudly next to Joe Biden, who was the author of the 1994 crime bill that led to the mass incarceration of Black people. This is the same woman who, as you pointed out in her book, talked about having more police because she knew then, as she knows now, that the Black community wants to have at least the same amount or more police in our communities because we want to be safe, we want to be secure, and we want to have protection from people who are seeking to do us harm and not be sitting ducks like the Defund the Police movement would do. But now, because she's an opportunist wanting to be the vice president and ultimately the president of the United States, she is going to flip-flop on her positions of defunding the police. She's going to flip-flop on her positions on issues that really she should be on the forefront of leading because she is a Black woman, but she's not, because she only cares about politics and not people. It's actually quite shameful.
Kamala Harris and Joe Biden took a different stance than they usually would. Kamala yesterday said that they weren't going to ban fracking or raise taxes. But we've seen that on numerous occasions, both Kamala and Joe Biden have said the exact opposite. Let's check it out.
Joe Biden will not raise taxes on anyone who makes less than $400,000 a year. He has been very clear about that.
One, I will repeal that tax bill.
On day one, we're going to repeal that tax bill.
On day one, we're going to repeal that tax bill.
On day one, we're going to repeal that tax bill.
Joe Biden will not end fracking. He has been very clear about that.
Would there be any place for fossil fuels, including coal and fracking, in a Biden administration?
No, we would work it out. We would make sure it's eliminated and no more subsidies for either one of them.
Well, like, what about, say, stopping fracking and stopping pipe?
What are your thoughts on that?
The Biden-Harris ticket is a ticket of political convenience, and it is a ticket of political polling. They run their policies by two instances. One, the radical left like AOC, Bernie Sanders, Elizabeth Warren, and the rest of the squad who actually guide their radical policies. And we know Kamala Harris is the most liberal senator in the United States Senate. And they also do it by polls. They look at the polls and say, okay, now we should not be for fracking because it looks like fracking is a good thing, especially for voters in Pennsylvania who support it. What we do know is that they have not changed their opinion on something called school choice and eliminating charter schools. And it's shameful. When you look at the majority of Black Americans, the majority of all Americans, Democrat, Republican, well-educated, not educated, nor from the North, from the South, from the East, or the West, it doesn't matter. It is a universally accepted type of policy that we have seen through multiple that say that the American people support school choice, except for when it comes to Joe Biden and Kamala Harris. I'd wish they'd flip-flop on that. I wish they would come to their senses and say, you know what? I stand with Secretary Betsy DeVos. I stand with President Donald J. Trump. I stand with Mike Pence. And I stand with the majority of Black Americans that say that they want to have school choice and charter schools for their children. But they won't do that, just like they won't flip-flop on their issue on abortion. I wish they would come to the senses and understand that when they stand there and take the endorsement of racist organizations like Planned Parenthood, who have historically and continue to target Black communities to kill and murder babies, I wish they would change their opinion on that, especially on the issue of late-term abortion. Also, on the issues which I wish they would flip on, they won't. And now when the last point I'll make is this. When Biden and Harris say that they will not raise taxes, they are lying. When they say that they will repeal the tax cuts that President Trump put into the law, that means that they will raise your taxes because those tax benefits and those rebates and everything that you got from that, especially the $2,000 that the majority of families received, will go away. So if they go away, your taxes will go up. And they know that. They're lying.
Mm-hmm. Let me ask you, if you were the moderator yesterday, what are some questions you would love to have asked Kamala and Pence?
Yeah, I would have asked Kamala Harris, number one, how can you stand before the American people and say on the one hand that you believe the accusers that have accused Joe Biden of assault like Tara Reid, but now stand silently as his VP nominee? How can you, Senator Harris, talk about criminal justice reform and being an advocate for criminal justice reform when you walked out of a meeting with Senator Tim Scott, refused to take a call from Jared Kushner to talk about the First Step Act, and actually have done everything but do things that would help give Black Americans a second chance? I would ask the last question for Senator Harris is, Senator Harris, how can you look the American people in the eye and say that you are someone who is honest and trustworthy and forthright when there's a pattern of flip-flopping in your record to make it seem as if you are just an opportunist? How can you defend the things that Joe Biden has said, the things that Joe Biden has done as a Black woman? And then to Vice President Pence, I would have asked Vice President Pence, how is it that you are so committed to the cause of making America great again, especially for the Black community? Can you tell us a little bit more about the Platinum Plan? Can you tell us about the things that you have done, the place that you have gone, the roundtables and the listening sessions that you have had with Black community members from the clergy, from business communities and from community leaders from your entire time, not only as a governor and as a congressman, but as the vice president? Let us know about your passion. Let us know about your heart for the community so that the American people, and more importantly, the Black community, can know more about the heart of this administration.
In the 2016 presidential election, President Trump received 8% of the Black vote. And as an advisor for Black Media Affairs, what are you doing? What strategies are being implemented in the Trump campaign to ensure that that percentage increases in 2020?
First of all, when President Trump got 8% of the Black vote in 2016, that was better than Senator McCain and Senator Romney when they were our Republican nominees. So if you go back, you will see reports that said that the president was going to get 0% of the vote, and he actually ended up getting 8%, which was significant. And I would also note that exit polling from CNN showed that he got 13% of the Black male vote, which is very important. Moving to 2020, the president now has a record of accomplishments for the Black community: support for school choice in HBCUs, which are historically Black colleges and universities, funding them fully, and for the first time, permanent funding for Title III Part F that was found in the Future Act. You have a president who stood up for the giving second chances to Black Americans through the First Step Act and criminal justice reform. The Tax Cuts and Jobs Act that I mentioned earlier that led to Opportunity Zones, which have already poured in $75 billion worth of capital investments in urban communities and distressed communities. This president has led and has a record of achievement. Moving forward, what we're doing now through our Black Voices for Trump community centers, which are in over a dozen urban Black communities all across this country, we are mobilizing, we are engaging, we are registering voters. We have people coming over to our side, hosting online and in-person events and safely knocking on doors and doing phone banking. We are engaging, we are in the community, we are present, especially in Black media. We're in newspapers and radio and television. We are going after the Black vote because President Trump wants to earn it and have the respect of the Black voters because he has a commitment that he's made to them and made to us, and he's kept his promise and he's kept his word. And now we have the Black Economic Empowerment Platinum Plan, which calls for $500 billion worth of capital investment into the Black community, 3 million new jobs and 500,000 new Black-owned businesses. And obviously something that nobody talks about is the fact that he calls for the KKK and Antifa to be labeled terrorist organizations and Juneteenth to be made a national holiday. This president has a lot of things that we are championing in the Black community, and we are seeing a lot of progress and a lot of people coming onto our side, especially after Joe Biden told the Black community, you ain't Black if you decide to vote for Donald Trump.
Yeah, let me ask, what was your reaction to that when you heard Joe Biden say that?
Here we go again, Joe Biden engaging in Black voter suppression and another bigoted comment. It was embarrassing. And I believe that Bob Johnson, the founder of BET, said it best. He said, after he heard that comment, Joe Biden should spend the rest of his time on the campaign trail apologizing to every Black person that he meets for that comment.
Now, I know the Trump campaign has had a pretty rough week, especially with Trump testing positive for COVID-19. How's the campaign doing this week?
We have Operation MAGA. We are full steam ahead. And we have our bus tours are still going. We have in-person events. We're still safely knocking on doors. We are going to win this campaign, and we are not going to stop. Ivanka Trump has been out doing fundraising, raised over $25 million. We are aggressively going after the vote because we are proud of the record the president has. So nothing has been able to stop us.
All right. So the Commission for Presidential Debate just announced this morning that the second presidential debate will be heard virtually. And, you know, President Trump has already said that he's not going to participate in that. What will he do instead? What is the alternative for him?
I believe the campaign said that they were going to have a host a rally or do some alternative type of way to message to the American people. But there's no makes no sense for the commission to capitulate to the Biden campaign so early and not allow data and science and testing to run its course and test the president the day of the event to see if he comes back negative and have the debate in person. They're just doing this to play politics and to appease the Biden campaign, who doesn't really want to debate anyway. So ultimately, as we saw, as foolish as those plexiglasses were last night, the VP debate that only had one side and every other side was open, that was just for show and for politics. They don't really care about people. They don't really care about what is actually going to go ahead and go on. The president didn't hold a debate in 2016. He instead had a event for veterans. He's going to do something for the American people this time around because the Biden campaign is working in cahoots with the commission. And it's unfortunate because the American people deserve to have an in-person debate with the issues, with the candidates, live and in living color.
Mm-hmm. All right. So one more message before you leave. If you were to send a message out there to an undecided voter, what would that be?
The message is simple. Vote your values and look at the facts. Do your homework. Look at the record of President Trump over the past 4 years, and you look at the record of President Trump and in terms of what he's done for every group in America. He's and his America First plan. And then look at the 47-year record of Joe Biden and Kamala Harris and see how they have failed America and not put America first. Do your homework. Vote your values. Vote President Trump.
All right. Thank you so much for joining us, Paris. Have a great day.
Thank you.